Hello and welcome to The Pulse. In this week's show, are whistleblowers like Edward Snowden and WikiLeaks a public service or a menace to society? And the release of mainland Chinese activist Tanzu Ren. But first, as you may know by now, Legislative Council President Jun Yuk-sing is to lead a delegation to visit Shanghai next weekend. Legislators are to have a half-day meeting with Wang Guangya, the director of the Hong Kong and Macau Affairs Office of the State Council, as well as seeing Li Fei, the chairman of the Hong Kong Special Administrative Region Basic Law Committee, and they'll see Zhang Xiaoming, the director of the Liaison Office. The topic they want to discuss is Hong Kong's political development.
All 43 of the pro-establishment legislators quickly agreed to join the Shanghai delegation. Leung Kwok Hung was the first of the pan-democrats to apply. Later, after the application deadline on Tuesday, another 11 Democratic legislators agreed to join the trip. After a meeting on Thursday night, the Democratic Party announced that members Helena Wong and Sin Chung-gai will also go.
We know this is not a negotiation. We just go up there to, we hope, to commence the dialogue. And my two colleagues will tell the Beijing officials to come to Hong Kong as soon as possible to hear the views of legislators, of civil society, and so that they really will understand how keen the Hong Kong people would like to have genuine election in 2017.
While some pan-democrats have requested an individual meeting with central government officials, three democratic legislators have vowed not to take part under current conditions. They voted against a motion on conducting a duty visit to Shanghai during a House committee meeting on Friday, the 28th of March.
I think the trip to Shanghai is politically and strategically divisive to pan-democratic political parties. The reason why I find it divisive is because the pan-democrats do not have a coherence and a concrete proposal for 2017 chief executive election. And if there's no bottom line and concrete proposal, it's quite difficult to negotiate, to discuss with the Beijing officials in Shanghai.
I do believe Hong Kong people want all discussion to be open and transparent. And if these two conditions can be fulfilled, the people power is quite willing to attend any meeting or the consultation session with the Chinese official, either in Hong Kong or even in Beijing.
This isn't the first time pan-democratic legislators have joined the Legislative Council delegation to the mainland. In September 2005, democratic legislators visited the Pearl River Delta. While there, they were able to express their views on the fight for universal suffrage to former secretary of CPC Guangdong Provincial Committee, Zhang Dezhang. The visit took place less than a month before the release of the fifth report of the Constitutional Development Task Force. In 2010, just five Democratic Party legislators joined a LegCo delegation to the Shanghai Expo. The so-called five-district referendum was held a week later. The pan-democrats were united in voting down proposals for the 2007 constitutional reforms, but they were split on the issue of the 2012 reforms. Eight Democratic Party legislators did vote for the government's constitutional reform package after a private meeting with the liaison office. This led to other pan-democrats accusing them of capitulation and did the party considerable harm among voters. But many pan-democrats remain pessimistic about the 2017 reforms.
We are afraid that the very same mistake will make by the Democratic Party. First, to have a closed-door negotiation with Beijing officials. And the second, they will give their critical vote to the government to pass a political reform package, which will not help Hong Kong people to win the implementation of universal suffrage.
I'm quite pessimistic regarding regarding the pandemic you know, United stand against the proposal, you know, if real democracy is not to be achieved. But I do believe we need Hong Kong people to come out, to fight for their right. If you rely just on the you know, pandemic legislative councillor, you know, I think they will be disappointed.
On Wednesday this week, Bill Micah, a former covert operative for the Canadian government, gave a speech at the Foreign Correspondents Club on how and why public safety has been compromised by allegedly reckless disclosures by digital anarchists masquerading as whistleblowers. This is contentious stuff. Well, Bill Micah is with us in the studio now. Let me ask you right now, I mean, what damage do you say has been done?
Well, I think there's been a great deal of damage that, you know, we may not even be aware of just yet, or something that's not been disclosed. From my personal perspective and experience, there's been reams of data that have been provided primarily through the WikiLeaks, if we deal with that specifically, with a lot of those cables. You know, there's somewhere north of a million, I believe, if not more, released. Within those cables, there would be seemingly benign information that dealt with commercial contacts involving embassy staff, diplomatic staff doing various duties. The reality is, what I used to be involved in was setting up covert infrastructure, especially in the post 9/11 climate. There became an awareness that there needed to be robust backstopping and covert infrastructure to protect our people operating globally in covert roles.
Okay, but let me stop you there. I mean, what you're saying, incidentally, is exactly what the State Department says. A lot of damage has been done. But when they've been asked, and I'll ask you the same question, so what is the damage? I mean, we haven't seen actual concrete examples of the damage that's allegedly been done.
Well, you know, that's a disingenuous argument, and I'll tell you why. The very act of acknowledging who, where, or what has been compromised will exponentially increase the risk to all those other people on the periphery. What people don't understand is governments set up do more than just put people into an undercover environment to do work. They have source witness relocation programs. They have families relocated. They have a need to pay informants, people who are cooperating, especially in countries where it's not a good thing to be seen cooperating with the authorities. So there have to be mechanisms and in some cases business enterprises set up and established to provide a layer of protection to this entire apparatus. And so within that apparatus, there would have been work done that would have gone through in classified documents and in information that on the surface by itself looks benign. But when brought together into a concerted effort, it lays out a totally different picture.
And one of the things that the publications, primarily the New York Times and the Guardian for that matter, say is that when they had this material, they just didn't release it wholesale. They did due diligence on it. They did very careful checking to make sure that it wouldn't hurt people.
Well, you know, that sounds good in theory and in principle, but then the comment I come back with is, who on the editorial board has the covert background? How many of them on the editorial board actually understand the covert methodologies that we use to set up our infrastructure?
But they have experience in handling information. I mean, this is what journalists do.
Right, but okay, let me ask you, you know, how have you ever set up covert ID? Have you ever set
that's
up bank accounts?
That's not what journalists
accounts?
Do. What journalists
but,
do
but that's what, but that's what we do in the covert
no, no,
world.
No, I know, but I mean, if you're to say that every piece of journalism, you can't report on buildings because you haven't built a building, you can't report on food because you haven't run a restaurant, that's the whole information industry dead tomorrow.
Well, I'm not saying that at all.
What I'm saying is, haven't been a covert operative, you can't possibly handle this information.
What I'm saying is, if you want to be a responsible journalist, then if you're going to report on information, you should know all facets and both sides of the story. Mm. Just going, you know, one of the great challenges is that there are many people in government who don't understand how these operations are set up and the detail that goes into it. The digital age is moving so fast that government can barely keep up. And what is the bottom line when we set this up? Protect the life of the undercover officer.
Well, hopefully that will happen. Thank you very much indeed. And we'll be back after the break. Welcome back. Last week, mainland Chinese dissident Tan Zuoren was released from prison after a five-year jail term. Tan was arrested on March 28, 2009, on charges of inciting subversion of state power because of essays he'd published criticizing the government verdict on the crackdown against the 1989 Tiananmen protests. But his supporters believe he was targeted because of his investigations into the collapse of school buildings during the 2008 Sichuan earthquake.
On
the 12th of May 2008, a magnitude 8 earthquake struck Sichuan. Once Tan Zuoren had seen the ruins of the collapsed Beichuan Middle School, he couldn't forget it. He began his own investigations and kept track of the students who died in the rubble of the shoddily constructed buildings. In March of 2009, Tan was accused of inciting subversion of state power. At the Chengdu Municipal Intermediate People's Court, he was sentenced to 5 years in prison. Last week, Tan was released. His supporters were waiting for him to come out of jail.
如果照传统观念来说，谭宗仁就是反革命。你敢支持反革命，要点勇气。本来我以为只有我一个人有那种勇气，后来我知道很多，我就佩服他们。就把它给拿给他看吧。这是艾薇薇的。 我不能把大嘴暴露了哈。做人你要知道，为什么我觉得你那个劳作的不冤呢？就是因为，如果你以前是一个人在战斗，现在就不是了，现在就是，数以万计、十万计的人了。你无非想唤起大家和你有共同的东西吗？
我们今后可以统计吧，居民房倒了多少，政府办公楼倒了多少，学校倒了多少，伤亡的数字，工人有多少，农民有多少，学生有多少，用数字说话。Tan
had proposed a 512 student archive, asking people who'd lost their children in the quake to set up a victim database, appealing to the public to demand an inquiry into their deaths and into why the school buildings had been so badly built. The pretext for his arrest was an article he'd previously written questioning the government verdict on the June the 4th incident. The arrest inspired human rights activists in many areas to continue the quest to discover the names of the students who had died.
本来那个话应该他自己亲自说，但是现在还没出来，我就代表他说了。谢谢大家，谢谢大家。Ahead
of Tan's release, human rights activists from Hunan, Guangdong, Nanjing, and Yan'an came especially to celebrate with Tan's wife Wang Qinghua and prepare for his homecoming. Some were old acquaintances, others hadn't even met Tan before, including Ye Du from Guangzhou.
Tan Zuoren先生呢，恰恰是这里面一个公民良知的代表。所以他这个事情呢，是在一般来说呢，在我们中国的这个自由主义知识分子和维权人士这里呢，大家都是那个知道这事情，并且很强烈的关注的。 所以，基于总理的英国杰多能博必须要到这里来，来表达一个对他对先生的敬意。我们从来没感到过，我们说最好的方法就是安慰好他的家人，接着做他的没有做完的事情。地震的关心呐、啊，地震的调查这方面呢、啊，一直深入啊。我们后面也我也写了文章，还有就是说那个家属的关心呐、啊。
Chen Yunfei and Tan first met before the earthquake. They've since collaborated in various human rights movements. Their hope is simple, that the next generation can live in a just society.
从感情来说，因为那牢狱里面，那么肯定是吃苦的。但是从另一个角度来，因为他这种吃苦啊，是为中国百姓，为整个成都啊，为这个八九一带啊，一个人受苦，那么更能换得更多的人不受苦，那么我觉得也是一种快乐。肯定整理过，你看看多整齐啊！那个没有一本倒着的书了吧？只要没有倒着的，就是我已经整理过了。 我反正不以不变应万变，我就在家里待着，是吧？他5年坐在监狱里边，我都没有压力。他出来了，我还有什么压力啊？我说了一个话，可能是对谭作人不尊重。我5年真的是玩过去的，而且他给我找到了一个玩的理由，就是说，有玩头，我打不赢，终会把那个事情。 搞得像滚雪球一样滚得越来越大就很好。随便哪个时代，必须有那么一波人，你要争取一些自由，你要想，就是用谭作人最朴实的话说，想你所爱的那个国家变得更美好，那你必须就要有牺牲的准备。言论不自由的话，那本来你就随时可能进去的。
Tan's wife, Wang Qinghua, has long psychologically prepared herself for a tough fight. But 5 years after the earthquake, even many of the parents of the students who died have given up the struggle to establish the responsibility of the authorities. Wang believes Tan won't be among those who will give up. Even after his imprisonment,
谭作人他们那个公民调查已经发到网上了，你也不可能再挑起新一轮的这个更大的风波了。我觉得，有的又另外生了孩子了，有的又被政府给招安了，有的又恐吓。他在做的时候，肯定他就会知道。
On Thursday, the 27th of March, Tan completed his sentence and was officially released from prison. He's said to be somewhere in Chongqing, but his exact whereabouts and that of his wife is unconfirmed. Fellow activist Ran Yunfei has said he met Tan after his release, but refuses to elaborate. Other supporters are still waiting for news.
就是说呢，我们呢都是到这里来迎接我们心目中的英雄谭作人先生，啊，那我们特地还踩点跑去了那个雅安监狱，今天呢我们就到那个雅安监狱啊大门外呢，用我们的行为。
表达了这个呢，我们大家伙对这个呢，谭作人先生的一个敬重。能够呢表达出了一个心意的话，这已经达到了那个目的了。让大家起码让大家看到了，你在这个国家里面，你只要坚持良心、良知和正义的话，是永远不会缺乏人去关注他们，让他们不会给世人所遗忘的。
小萌。
爸爸没还没回来？
还没有。
啊？
今天早上我起来就看见他不在了，我以为他去接爸爸了，但是电话也打不通。
啊，我觉得这个国家是这样的，就是对上面不利的事情那就要打压，蛮正常的。我虽然很支持他这样，但是我觉得，平民百姓还是只有忍了吧。像他这样子就只有吃苦的份了。我就当是他明天回来吧，明天在家里面等他。
We'll see you at the same time next week. Until then, goodbye.
Riders on the storm. Riders on the storm. Into this house we're born. Into this world we're thrown. Like a dog with a